Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the seventh FOGSI webinar on the topic biochemical test. I'll quickly share the agenda for today. Dr. Mandakini Pradhan will be doing the introduction and give the welcome address to Dr. Rusha. Our first speaker is going to be Dr. Shalini Tripathi, and the second speaker for today's webinar is Dr. Sunita Bijania. So without wasting any further time, I would quickly like to call upon Dr. Mandakini Pradhan, who is the chairperson of Genetic and Fetal Medicinal Committee at FOGSI, so that she can introduce Dr. Rusha.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this seminar. This is the last of the series through all type of tests that can be done. How to collect a sample, how the tests are done, so that at least the basic knowledge we will have. And today we have planned to do on inborn error of metabolism. In our day-to-day practice, we must have seen many patients coming to us with previous history of baby, either suspected to have inborn error of metabolism that Dr. Sunita and Dr. Shalini will highlight. But then in our day-to-day practice, we suspect probably it could be inborn error of metabolism. And that's an area which is, which many of the gynecologists are not very comfortable with. Even the pediatrician are not very comfortable with, because the metabolism are so difficult to remember. Genetics has made us life easy in the way you can do a gamut of tests together. So that is probably an easy way of looking at it. But Dr. Shalini and Dr. Sunita will be highlighting how this will be helpful to us. I'm very, very thankful and honored to welcome Usha Sharma ma'am, who has encouraged not only me, many people, many young people to do education to the gynecologist, then do their own work in their field. She is one of those who have encouraged me also in my early days, and even now also, anything new, and specifically planning for inborn error of metabolism goes to you, madam. Once when you planned a whole seminar on inborn error of metabolism, I never thought about it. I always think on going on thinking NIPT, then aneuploidy, and then single gene disorder. We never got into inborn error of metabolism. That stimulated me to think about a whole seminar on inborn error of metabolism. Dr. Usha Sharma is the president of ISOPARB, that is Indian Society of Perinatology and Reproductive Biology. She is honored consultant in Red Cross Polyclinic, and previously she was chairperson of Safe Motherhood Committee. During her chairpersonship, she did a lot of work in safe motherhood, so that the pregnancy care is taken care of. Delivered many keynote addresses. Everyone in FOGSI knows her. She is very, very active in FOGSI, currently in ISOPARB, then RCOG. Contributed many chapters in FOGSI publication. She is from East Zone Fellow Representative for RCOG. So those who are attending this lecture, remember that she is one of those representative of RCOG. So you have any confusion in a whole lot gamut of examination, she is one of them who can clarify it. So welcome you, ma'am. Thank you. At the beginning, at least I must thank you for encouraging this inborn error of metabolism topic into this series of webinar. Such type of webinar are not listened in our gynecology seminars or set of seminars that we these days organizing. So welcome you, ma'am. And thank you so much for being associated with us. Over to you, ma'am.
First of all, I congratulate you, Mandakini, for hosting this educational webinar series with the theme Genetics from Laboratory to Clinical Practice. I had put that theme in my webinar because I don't understand the subject very well and keep referring the patients to you that you know very well. Now, and thank for inviting me. We are proud and appreciate your work in genetics and fetal medicine. Keep going. One day you will astonish everybody. As the researchers are cracking codes of genetics for various disorders, it is need of the hour to update ourselves. And that is why I think this is a topic which needs time and time again to be discussed. And all the gynecologists, neonatologists, pediatricians, all of us should be updated about it. Today's deliberation by a learned speaker, Dr. Shalini, whom I have heard before, and she had given an excellent deliberation from KGMC Lucknow on diagnosis of inborn errors of metabolism, followed by test ordering and interpretation for inborn errors of metabolism by another learned speaker, Dr. Sunita Bijarnia, who is a senior consultant in medical genetics and genomics at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. We all are going to get updated and current guidelines on this complex subject regarding diagnosis and management of the neonate. I wish this educational pursuit a great success. Plus, welcome all of you to this knowledge enhancing webinar. Once again, thank you for inviting me.
And thank you, ma'am, for that encouraging words. I shift on to Ms. Geeta so that she can carry forward our this webinar. I request all those who are participating, this is our last one on the series. Those who have registered will get a link to see the review the this presentation. Second thing is, if you have any questions or any doubts, please clarify your doubts in your Q&A section or in the chat box. Like, we see both of them. So at the end, it will be discussed. These seminars are not all those 15 minutes or 20 minutes talk. It elaborates you, it gives you a chance to think about and then have a relook. So we are not in a hurry, or there is nothing hussus or fuss about this as a webinar. So you please feel free to see what is happening and clear your doubts. Okay, thank you. Over to Geeta.
Thank you, Dr. Mandakini and Dr. Usha. So I will be introducing our first speaker, Dr. Shalini Tripathi. Dr. Shalini is an additional professor in Department of Pediatrics at King George Medical Hospital in Lucknow. So she has an observership in neonatology from Cleveland Clinic in Ohio in USA. Her areas of interest are neonatal research, inborn error of metabolism, and genetics in newborn. She is a national trainer for facility-based newborn care, as well as facility-based integrated management of neonatal and childhood illness. She is a nodal person for congenital birth defect surveillance, WHO-0, as well as congenital rubella surveillance in India. She was associated with ICMR for that. So she is also associated with Comprehensive Lactation Management Center with Human Milk Bank at Dhatri Amrit Kailash in KGMU. She is a reviewer for BMJ Pediatrics and Indian Journal of Pediatrics, and also a member of IAP, NNF, ISOPARAP, and Human Milk Bank Association. So over to Dr. Shalini for her talk.
So a very good afternoon to all of you. And I'm very thankful, first of all, to Dr. Mandakini, ma'am, who has given me this opportunity to connect again with the obstetrical colleagues. So once again, we are discussing, this is a very important topic in today's view, because now we have got a lot of tools in our hands, including the genetic assessment of a lot of disorder in just one go. So without wasting any more time, I will be coming to my talk, which is the inborn errors of metabolism. However, it is a difficult and a new topic, but I would like to make it as comfortable as I can. So I'm just starting with this case. There was a patient, a 3 kilo male baby who was delivered vaginally by the emergency cesarean section. And suddenly was absolutely well.
Shalini.
So this baby was a male baby delivered cesarean section and was well till 48 hours of life. But then suddenly had a seizure at 48 hours. So suddenly the baby developed irritability, vomiting, refusal to feed, and there were no risk factor also for the sepsis. So the baby came to the NICU, was lethargic, and respiratory gases showed respiratory metabolic alkalosis because the child was hyperventilating. And because of the high index of suspicion of inborn error of metabolism, blood ammonia levels were done and they came to be 550 millimoles per liter. So how we are going to manage this baby? So this is the case which I will explain in detail later. So actually, if we start just a history of inborn error of metabolism, so this is the person, Dr. Robert Guthrie, who actually first of all discovered phenylketonuria and utilized filter paper for sample collection. And his method of sample collection is still used all over the world. And he began the screening with one disorder only of phenylketonuria. But now we are able to test many conditions with just one drop of blood. And if we see the disorders tested, one disorder was started in 1960. 1980s, five disorders were there. In 2000, 45 disorders were discovered in this category. And now in 2020, we are having 200 plus disorders under the category of inborn error of metabolism, which we can diagnose. So first screening by Guthrie's test, then the testing started as ELISA test was started. But then because we wanted more test and economically better test with a better speed of the test of mass screening, so the automations were done. And now the tandem mass spectroscopy is the technique. And finally, the gas chromatography and mass spectroscopy as the test evolved. And finally, now the most important is the next generation sequencing in the molecular. We can even diagnose each and every disorder up to the molecular level. So these are the gradual improvement from 1970s to 2020. So what is an inborn error of metabolism? So inborn error of metabolism is a genetically determined biochemical disorder which affects the individual's ability to convert nutrients like carbohydrate, fats, and proteins and utilize them for the energy production. So in that cycle, some enzyme is missing. Because of the missing enzyme, we are not able to utilize them. And they typically present in the newborn period as soon as the baby is offered milk. And mainly in the milk, the main compound which actually creates the problem is the protein. So identification and treatment of this disorder before it really becomes irreversible is very, very crucial for the babies. And advanced technologies like tandem mass spectroscopy, which allows the simultaneous detection of multiple analytes, improve the outcomes of patients with inborn error of metabolism. So actually, I was just telling the pathophysiology that mainly there is a substrate A, which with the help of enzyme 1 converts to B, and B converts to C with enzyme 2, and C converts to D by enzyme 3. So if there is deficiency of enzyme 1 by a point mutation, so the A accumulates. And this substrate accumulation will give rise to certain problems in the newborn baby. And this in turn produces certain more toxic thing to the body, which is E and F. And this buildup of this toxic metabolite F actually leads to all multiple level damages in which mainly brain, heart, and liver. They are the three main structures which are affected. Also what happens, the A is not able to convert into C. So because of that, there is deficiency of C, and that also leads to some functional dysfunction. So Gerard's hypothesis was given, which says that prior to delivery, fetus is usually protected because of the maternal removal of these toxic metabolites and the provision of the energy by the mother. But as soon as the baby is born, the baby will actually start manifesting these problems, because now toxic metabolite will getting on there in the baby's blood, and the energy will not be utilized in the body. So if we see the newborn screening program before all this actually manifest, it diagnoses all those disorders. And in all the countries like USA 100%, UK 100%, the newborn screening programs are running. And in India, because of the other problems which are much more common and causing newborn deaths, like neonatal sepsis, birth asphyxia, our government is not yet started. So the incidence of inborn error of metabolism, if we see, they are basically more than 500 recognized disorder which we can diagnose. And approximately 25% of all these disorder, they manifest in the newborn period. And according to the ICMR task force, the most common disorder which are manifesting in our newborns in India, organic acidemia and amino acidopathies are very common. And among amino acidopathies, methyl malonic acidemia followed by propionic acidemia is the most common. And amino acidopathies, maple syrup urine disease and classic citrullinemia are common. So if we say that individual disorders, so different studies are there which quote different disorders which are very, very rare. However, if we see all the sick babies, the incidence of inborn error of metabolism can be as high as 74 babies per 1,000 babies tested. So now I'm coming to the categories. So there are many classification based upon the enzyme deficiency, based on the substrate. But if we see the effect, overall effect in the metabolic derangement, the inborn error of metabolism, they are mainly of three types. First are the intoxication effects. Second category is the enzyme deficiency. And third are the disorders of complex molecule. So among the intoxication effect, basically the metabolites, they accumulate in the body and they provide a toxic effect on different organs. So the individual will have at least a time of around 2-3 days before he gets really sick. And in this, all these acute disorders of amino acidopathies, in which mainly phenylketonuria, maple syrup urine disease, homocystinuria, urea cycle defect, in which citrullinemia and arginosuccinic aciduria, organic acidemia, in which three types of organic acidemia, as I have already told, they are most common, and disorders of sugar metabolism, in which galactosemia and hereditary fructose intolerance are common. These four disorders, they present as intoxication category. So they mainly manifest as soon as the babies are given milk, mother's milk or formula milk, and they're exposed to the protein. So, and phenylketonuria is very, very common in the West. It's not that common in our country. And it also doesn't manifest as an acute lethargic baby in newborn period. It mainly presents as microcephaly in the later in the life and with the various symptoms like cerebral palsy. However, the disorders like maple syrup urine disease, they are more common in which present as acute metabolic encephalopathy. Then other disorders like organic acidemia, what happens? The symptoms, they appear shortly after the protein intake and the baby is absolutely well for the first 24-48 hours and then suddenly develops vomiting, lethargy, seizures, coma, leading to death. Second category is the energy deficiency. So these are the three groups in which basically the energy deficiency, because the substrate is not metabolized. So in this, fatty acid oxidation defect, glycogen metabolism and gluconeogenesis, if the baby is starved or sepsis, then he will crash down because he is not able to really cope up with that crisis. Then mitochondrial respiratory chain disorders, in which pyruvate dehydrogenase complex deficiency is there. So all these three will come into the second group of energy deficiency. Also congenital lactic acidosis. So in this, there's a energy impairment is there. So babies will be asymptomatic for a long time. However, whenever there's a fasting, and in the newborn fasting, usually hypoglycemia occurs when they are having infection or in the sepsis, or the baby in the glycogen storage disorders, in which hypoglycemia can also occur in any condition of the stress. So they will present after a long time, not that early as the first toxic metabolite group was presenting. So the second group is the energy deficiency. Then we have, this is the most unknown group actually, most underdiagnosed group, is the complex molecule disorders, in which lysosomal disorders, peroxisomal disorders, and the congenital disorders of glycosylation are there. So in this, gradual and progressive intake is there, and they're not related to any food intake. So how these babies will actually present? So the main problem is that the symptoms are really, really non-specific, and the most important diagnosis we will always, as a neonatologist, any person or any gynecologist will always suspect in a baby who is lethargic. First diagnosis will always be sepsis, HIE, cardiac lesions who are mainly duct dependent, early lesions like TGA, TAPVC, then endocrinal disorders, even more common than IEM, like congenital adrenal hyperplasia, torch infections. So these are the very common disorders. But what happens, even a very small proportion of the babies in our country are IEM, they are basically drowned under this huge umbrella of sepsis and HIE. And the symptoms are so non-specific. And also the awareness about the neonatologist and pediatricians about those clues is very less. So that is the reason these diagnoses are usually, these are actually underdiagnosed. So what are the pointers for IEM? So any baby who is actually having a normalcy and then sudden catastrophic crash occurs in that baby, and there's a parental consanguinity is present that actually increases the autosomal recessive disorders, history of sibling death or sudden deaths in the family, they're saying ki suddenly jo hai wo bachcha sota sota uski death ho jata hai, 3-4 bachchon mein aisa ho chuka hai, and in certain religions, there is a lot of consanguinity, and that basically leads to increase in these disorders. Then unexplained lethargy. And unexplained means we have done all the tests to rule out sepsis, intraventricular bleed, and we are really not able to find out the cause. Then one should be alert about these disorders. And the baby is having hypotonic, coma, convulsion. There was no asphyxia. So there's a time to suspect about this disorder. Severe, very severe metabolic acidosis. So in the sepsis, normally the lactic acid is as high as 5. But if we are getting lactic acidosis more than 20, so it is more in favor of very severe metabolic acidosis. The baby is having, without any cause, persistent vomiting. In fact, many babies of IEM are operated and they are misinterpreted as a hypertrophic pyloric stenosis because the baby was having continuous vomiting. Peculiar odors in the baby like maple syrup, intractable hiccups, and also acute fatty liver or HELLP disorder in the babies and the mothers who are carrying the fetuses. This disorder in which there's a long chain 3 hydroxy dehydrogenase deficiency, there is a recurrent losses are there in these mothers if the fetus has got this disorder. And there are many disorders, especially the lysosomal storage disorder, in which there are non-immune fetal hydrops will be there in the mother. So there are many pointers and there are many syndromes. So the presentation mainly affects the liver symptomatology, or the pattern can be an acute metabolic encephalopathy, or there will be some abnormality in the facies, or there is some cardiomyopathy. So if we are not aware of these things, we will not be able to suspect in any of these babies that they are having this peculiar. And sometimes these peculiar things are common in every baby born. So if we are really thinking about the inborn error of metabolism, then only we can think about it. So first and the most difficult one is actually the babies who are presenting with encephalopathy. So the first disorder which I will suspect with encephalopathy is always urea cycle defect. After that is organic acidemia. So urea cycle defect that leads to hyperammonemia will be first suspicion in any baby who is presenting unexplained metabolic encephalopathy. Also in second and third will be actually the organic acidemia and maple syrup urine disease. Then if the baby is having intractable seizures without any cause, then the pyridoxine dependency, non-ketotic hyperglycemia, molybdenum cofactor deficiency, they are the 3 highest priorities if the baby is having intractable seizures, and I'm thinking about these disorders. then if a baby is having a liver pattern, so the pattern can be either acute liver failure or it can be a neonatal cholestasis. In the acute liver failure, the most common cause, the most common inborn error of metabolism presenting as ALF is tyrosinemia. And the second important cause, the causes are galactosemia, neonatal hemochromatosis, which is now actually called as gestational alloimmune liver disease, and glycogen storage disease type 4 can also present as acute liver failure in newborn babies. Then the babies can be absolutely normal, direct bilirubin high in that baby without any cause. Then the inborn error, which is presenting as this, is alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency and Niemann Pick type C. If we are having a cardiac presentation, so in the newborn baby, Pompe's disease, that is glycogen storage disease type 2, is the first possibility. And also the respiratory chain disorder, some fatty acid oxidation defect can have that. Sometimes the newborn baby will have persistent hypoglycemia, which we say that if we are giving glucose infusion for 7 days and we are not able to maintain the glucose without IV supply, without giving IV in glucose infusion. And the highest on that, the first priority should be galactosemia, then glycogen storage disorders, gluconeogenesis defect, organic acidemia, and fatty acid oxidation defects. Now, there can be many times the gynecologist, they are feeling that every time the hydrops happens, and there are many, apart from the this immunological causes like Rh incompatibility and renal disease, etc. The non-immune causes are lysosomal storage disorder, in which these are the groups like mucopolysaccharidosis type 1, 4, and 7, and sphingolipidosis, mucolipidosis, lipid storage disorders. So sensitivity of the gynecologist that if a recurrent hydrops is happening without any reason, then these syndromes, Jellweger syndrome and congenital disorder of glycosylation, they can be the causes. So if the most difficult, I have already told that acute metabolic encephalopathy, if I'm having a baby in which I'm not able to, there's no meningitis, there is no bleed, there is no sepsis, nothing is there. So the highest priority is urea cycle defect and organic acidemia. So in this, the full-term baby, normal at birth, becomes lethargic and poor after the feeding of milk intake, which contains protein. So the babies, there is very important to diagnose that the babies, they will be always tachypneic, that leads to CO2 washout. So in the ABG, we will be finding always there is a CO2 washout, that is respiratory alkalosis. But in organic acidemia, we will be finding metabolic acidosis. So the babies, they hyperventilate in urea cycle defect. And because of the persistent vomiting, many times they are misinterpreted as pyloric stenosis. And sepsis has to be considered first in all the cases. But it is also a very important coexistent thing in all the metabolic disorders. So we cannot say that this person is having inborn error of metabolism, but not sepsis. But because of the sepsis, many babies, they actually precipitate. So in encephalopathy group, urea cycle disorder is with respiratory alkalosis and organic acidemia is with metabolic acidosis. So hyperammonemia, unexplained vomiting, lethargy, and evidence of encephalopathy, we should always do the ammonia levels. And it is very important to note that when we are sending the ammonia level in the newborn or many other things in the investigations, we have to send in a very strict laboratory environment. Like ammonia is always sent in a ice bag. It has to be, the sample is sent to the lab and many labs are not doing it. There are very particular labs who are doing that and giving the correct estimation of ammonia. So ammonia interpretations, if the normal values are like 60 to 100, but 100 to 500 can be there in many conditions like sepsis and prematurity, herpes simplex, simplex infection, perinatal asphyxia. However, if the levels are really high, if it is more than 500, we should always have an antenna alert that this baby is having IEM. And if the ammonia levels are increasing up 1000, it is very, very diagnostic that this is because of the urea cycle defect. So if there's a hyperammonemia, we immediately have to do the hemodialysis, or if that is not possible, peritoneal dialysis in these babies so that that toxic metabolite always goes out. Otherwise, it will lead to fatal hepatic necrosis. So approach to this baby who is having hyperammonemia. So if we are seeing this baby initially in the first 24 hours and the baby is really small, then it is just a transient hyperammonemia, which is called as THAN, and which usually has got a very good prognosis. And in that ammonia, we don't treat that for transient hyperammonemia of newborn. However, if the levels are really high and the baby is not preterm, full term, and is not associated with any acidosis, the first diagnosis will always be urea cycle. And in urea cycle, we always do the plasma amino acid test to check for the citrulline level. And this citrulline level, if it is absent, we again have to basically differentiate between two types, CPS deficiency and OTC, by doing the urinary orotic acid. So there are three level tests, which gradually one has to do when we diagnose the urea cycle defect. So plasma citrulline, when we do, it is not also very easily available test, and we really have to ask the labs, and it is not accurately measured in all the labs. So even if we find that this is a urea cycle defect and this is a female, so we can very easily say that it is not OTC, because OTC is an X-linked disorder. So it is very rare to be carbamoyl palmitoyl sulfate deficiency is common in both the sexes. If it is a male and we are finding the urea cycle defect with absent citrulline, the diagnosis straight away goes to the CPS deficiency, and the dietary measurements are started for the urea cycle defect. Then the second very important is for metabolic acidosis. So in metabolic acidosis, for to begin with, I should always think in my mind that if it is an increased anion gap and no other sepsis and no other things are there, and it's very high, inborn error of endometabolism should be thought. And the largest group is organic acidemia. So organic acidemia has this actually has all the three things. It also has the increased ammonia levels, but they will not be as high as urea cycle. And they also had ketones present. And there are three disorders in this organic acidemia, in which methylmalonic acidemia and propionic acidemia are most common. And very interesting thing and very good thing in that methylmalonic acidemia responds very well to B12. So diagnosing methylmalonic acidemia gives a very good prognostic value to the baby. And these two disorders, methylmalonic acidemia and propionic acidemia, they also cause a bone marrow suppression like thing. So CBC, we will be finding the leukopenia and thrombocytopenia in these two disorders. So there are case reports that these disorders of acidosis, because acidosis is equal to sepsis, septic shock, and we always think that this is sepsis, and given antibiotics, but actually it is inborn error of metabolism. So suppose the patient is having all the blood cultures negative, sepsis screen, tests of sepsis negative, and always suspect organic acidemias in the view of sepsis with mild elevations of ammonia with the ketones positive in urine. So this is also algorithm. I will not go in much detail. I've already discussed that organic acidemia, we will always think whenever we have a metabolic acidosis with ketosis with moderate hyperammonemia. Now, the third and very, we have done, there is no encephalopathy. There is encephalopathy, but there is no ammonia raised and there is no acidosis. So these are the very, very difficult, and they're actually rare disorders. But there are three disorders which among these are the most common. The first is the non-ketotic hyperglycemia. In this, the amino acid glycine is raised and the patient will have metabolic encephalopathy, the increased glycine in the plasma TMS, and CSF glycine versus plasma glycine ratio will be increased, and the diagnosis will be dietary protein restriction. Sodium benzoate will be given in all these disorders to chelate the amino acid to and to convert it into a excretable form. So it is converted into hippuric acid, and the sodium benzoate basically removes the nitrogen. One mole of sodium benzoate basically removes one mole of nitrogen of these cycles. However, even if the diagnosis of NKH is made, they don't have a good prognosis. Second disorder in this encephalopathy, in which there's no ammonia, there's no acidosis, molybdenum cofactor deficiency, an important clue is this disorder is zero or very minimal uric acid. So if the uric acid is low, if we have this clue, we can just do that test and we find non-detectable uric acid in the serum. So molybdenum cofactor deficiency, actually, also there's a detection of sulfites in the urine because there is a deficiency of co-deficiency of sulfite oxidase in this. So the sulfites will be positive. So this there will be hypouricemia and ectopia lentis in the can happen if the baby survives the newborn period. Then third is the respiratory chain disorders. So respiratory chain disorder is an important group in which they present as encephalopathy because baby is not able to do the utilization of the substrate. So at the brain level, the baby is in encephalopathy. There's no ammonia raised. There's no acidosis. However, we have to differentiate two types in which one is lactate is increased and second is lactate is not increased. In that, we have to do the LP ratio, that is lactate pyruvate ratio and plasma pyruvate levels. So I've written the normal values in the normal individual, it should be less than 25. And if the values are more than 25, that is lactate pyruvate ratio is more than 25, this makes the diagnosis of respiratory chain disorder. So again, suppose the baby is hyperventilating, there's encephalopathy ho raha hai, liver is increased, the baby is having Ray syndrome like respiratory feature, there's a respiratory alkalosis, and the ammonia is more than 500, there's no acidosis, so the urea cycle first. Severe metabolic acidosis, all the septic screen is negative, gram-negative sepsis like picture, hyperammonemia borderline, 200 to 500, and some cytopenias is there, but it's not like DIC, so always think of organic acidemia. Mild acidosis, maple syrup like urine odor and urine ketones very, very high. Ferric chloride test positive, increased tone and hyperintensity in the myelinated brain in the MRI. We will think about maple syrup urine disease. And in the ICMR, the survey, maple syrup urine disease was the most common aminoacidopathies which was diagnosed. And intractable seizure, even in the in utero seizure, this non-ketotic hyperglycemia, the baby may be born with seizures, in-uterine seizures, on day one immediately without any asphyxia, opsoclonus, myoclonus, and bachche ko hichki aati ja rahi hai, hiccups, and there is no acidosis, no ABG disturbance, and CSF glycine versus plasma glycine is increased. We will think about NKH. Then this disorder of, if we are, I'm able to see the hypoglycemia and urine reducing substance is positive. So galactosemia is the first diagnosis of any baby who is having hypoglycemia with cholestasis, with bilateral cataracts, with E. coli sepsis. First diagnosis, bilateral cataract, E. coli sepsis, very, very common to happen in galactosemia. Then this disorder, which is called as biotinidase deficiency. अगर इस डिसऑर्डर की बात की जाए तो दिस इज वी आर द न्यूनेटोलॉजिस्ट और पीडियाट्रिशियन इज द हैप्पीएस्ट व्हेन दिस इज डायग्नोज्ड इन अ बेबी विद एनकेफलोपैथी और इंट्रैक्टेबल सीजर्स बिकॉज द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ अ वेरी लो कॉस्ट बायोटिन टैबलेट गिव्स वेरी वेरी गुड रिजल्ट्स एंड द बेबीज दे इवन विद हैविंग एमआरआई चेंजेस वी हैव सीन द नॉर्मल टू बेबीज आर देयर of biotinidase deficiency under the follow-up, and the regression has already gone and they are developing normally and they are doing really well with biotins. So if any baby is having continuous convulsions and rash all over the body, that is a clue, and alopecia, that is a clue, and that is called as biotinidase deficiency. So although this is juggler's box and it's very difficult to really diagnose this, but to diagnose, we have to first have the pointers. So I will always think for a baby who is having sick and who is first, I will rule out the common diagnosis. Then think about some pointers, hepatic, cardiac, encephalopathy. And then I will do the first line investigations, which will surely include the ABG, lactate, ammonia, glucose, urine ketones, and reducing substance. And then to see those whole investigation at the background of the baby, and then to find out ki wo algorithm mein kahan pe aa raha hai. And finally, to test for that particular enzyme or for organic acids. So organic acids are done usually in the urine. So GMSA scan is basically GCMS is done for organic acid assays, and for amino acid estimations in the serum, TMS is usually done. So if I'm really not able to understand, and it's better, and if the patient can afford, the TMS, GCMS both together can be done. But I'm very particular about galactosemia, then only one enzyme is usually done. This is combined with the MRI, EEG, and genetic tests. So complete blood count will, neutropenias will give a clue about organic acidemias, acidosis, alkalosis will give the clue, and liver function test, and ferric chloride test for maple syrup urine disease, and ketones, these tests have to be done in all the babies who are suspected with IEM. Then the second level test, in which the gas chromatography mass spectroscopy of the urine and the amino acid and the carnitine profile by tandem mass spectroscopy is done for the amino acid metabolism and fatty acid oxidation. GCMS is mainly for the organic acids which are raised, and there are different peaks are there for different metabolites which are increased. Then for respiratory chain disorder, in which there's encephalopathy, there is no acidosis, there is no hyperammonemia, the CSF lactate and pyruvate ratio for mitochondriopathies or respiratory chain disorders. Then urinary orotic acid is done in to bifurcate the, finally delineate the urea cycle defect. Plasma long chain fatty acid if you are suspecting the paroxysmal disorders. CSF amino acid and analysis, EEG, MRI, and then final testing about the mutation. So if somebody is able to diagnose that particular disorder like galactosemia or some disorder, maple syrup urine disease, then the SA DNA estimation has to be done. But it's very important that whenever the TMS and GCMS tests are done, usually the babies in the nursery, they are very, very sick. Sometimes they are just dying and they are nil oral. And if the feeding is stopped, then actually all these results, they will be false negative. So because all these toxic metabolites are accumulating only when the feeding baby is fed. So we have to ensure that, because they are the costly tests, around costing 3,000 plus bucks to the patient. So we have to really ensure that the feeds are given, even if in a minimal amount it can be given. And there are certain things like ammonia, lactate, all these samples are transported in ice, and detailed history of drugs has to be given, like valproate, which usually normally increases ammonia. It's ammonia. So it increases ammonia. And it is better to stop valproic acid in any newborn who is having hyperammonemia. So TMS has got a very low specificity. It has got a very false high positive values. And sometimes we do the TMS testing and GCMS testing in the healthy newborn babies, in the context of a bad obstetrical history of the previous sibling deaths, then that it is very important to interpret and tell the interpretation to the parents in a normal way, and to keep the baby, rather giving a judgmental statement to the parents, having or not having a disease. It's better to keep the baby in track, especially if the baby is asymptomatic and we are ordering some tests because of the bad history in the family. So important thing is that sometimes the glucose reducing substance is done for galactosemia. So the people, they do the reducing substance, and if it is positive, that is not glucose. It is actually the non-glucose reducing substance. So first the glucose stick test has to be done. That should be negative. And in that case, if the Benedict's is positive, we will say it is something other than glucose. like fructose or galactose, then only it will be said as positive. So we have to write very properly non-glucose reducing substance, and for consecutive few days, like minimum 2 days, have to be sent for having some interpretation of those tests. And the most common disorders which give the rise to the positive is galactosemia and fructosuria, which present as hypoglycemia and cholestasis in the newborn. So this is a slide which tells sometimes the baby, even the baby is born, is dead in the NICU, or then also we want to make a diagnosis for the prenatal diagnosis before for the next pregnancy. So some samples, they can be kept for diagnosis, like keeping plasma 3 to 5 ml in the heparin, or whole blood for different testing, and blood spot, just taking a blood spot on filter paper will work, and CSF. And if nothing is there in the ulic, that baby is dysmorphic, then just a clinical photograph. An infantogram is asked if the baby every time is having some skeletal deformity of scoliosis, kyphosis. So for those babies who have even died, these things, they should be always collected. So we have, I think, done all this. So when we do the gas chromatography, GCMS, so different metabolites are increased above the normal population. Then the lab gives us that this out of these 100 metabolites, these 3 metabolites, 4 metabolites are increased. And then the final interpretation. So that interpretation we have to done at the background of the patient. Sometimes there was a patient, there was interpretation was just not matching. So we have to cross check with the lab. So now, very short, the treatment of these babies is mainly the general management, and second for the suspected disorder and the long-term management. So general management is mainly immediately, if we are thinking about an inborn error of metabolism, we have to stop all the protein which is going to the baby through milk. So feeding has to be stopped. Of course, after stabilizing the baby, the shock, everything has to be managed. And everything what goes only by IV glucose, and lipids can also go. So IV straight away, nil oral has to be done. The baby should be nil oral. IV glucose or lipids can be given. We have to maintain the fluid electrolyte balance. And then toxic metabolites removal by doing peritoneal dialysis. And that is actually the life saving, in which peritoneal dialysis, we have saved one baby, in which although finally baby expired later on by sepsis, but initially the ammonia levels are so high that we have to remove them. Otherwise the babies, they crash. Then there are specific protocols. If the baby is having hyperammonemia, suspecting organic acidemia, we have to give that particular protocols. So I will not give for hyperammonemia. We actually give all these babies sodium benzoate, and that sodium benzoate is not available in IV. So the same dose which is given in West by IV, we here give the sodium benzoate, and that is basically taken from the grocer shop, the same benzoate salt. And that is given the same dose loading followed by oral. The oral is given because we don't have the IV available. And the other, this basically combines with the arginine and converts to hippuric acid that gets excreted in the urine. So that is life-saving. And so sodium benzoate is given for amino acidopathies. If we say for treatment, for tyrosinemia, we have treatment available in which oral nicitinone is the drug which is given, which halts the ongoing liver damage. However, later on, finally, the babies have to be on hepatic transplantation. For our organic acidemia, I have told that B12 is very, very important. We can give, and for any baby with IEM, valproic acid has to be stopped. So B12 can be magical in organic acidemia, especially the methyl malonic acid and propionic acidemia. And suppose there is a sibling, there's a history of sibling deaths, and that other baby is absolutely healthy. So the particular protocol has to be followed, that we have to admit that healthy baby, and we have to gradually initiate the breastfeeding, because abhi to baby theek hai, but 2 din ke baad suddenly wo down ho sakta hai agar wo ghar chala gaya. So initial protein gradually 0.25 grams se karte karte usko normal badha ke, basic metabolites then have to be taken out only after the feeding is started, And then you see the metabolite screen. And if the baby is well, then can be sent back home with the continuous follow-up of that healthy baby. So then long-term treatment, the different formula, which don't have the proteins, these were not available, but now many new companies are coming up with the formulas for PKU, phenylketonuria, maple syrup urine disease, homocystinuria are available, galactosemia. For galactosemia, we have to stop galactose and we can just start the soy milk. Soy milk formula can be added. And enzyme replacement therapy is now available, although for glycogen storage disorders, although they do not manifest, apart from these Pompe's disease, none of these manifest in newborn period, but very good for these babies that enzyme replacement therapy is available, which is given in very selected centers. So then finally, the genetic counseling is done. So we know that they are actually the single gene disorder. So now it is diagnosed. Again, there's a risk, 25% risk in the next pregnancy. So it's important to do the CVS. It's 100% important. If the index case has got a confirmed DNA analysis for the next pregnancy by doing the CVS and amniocentesis, the testing can be done. The test can be offered into that sample of metabolites can be detected, or even enzyme assay like GALT assay into that CVS sample. Or the best is actually the molecular diagnosis, in which Sanger sequencing or next generation sequencing in that sample must be offered if the index case is diagnosed. So now I'm coming to that baby. This was a 3 kilo baby who was all well after 48 hours, suddenly had metabolic encephalopathy. And the neonatologist earlier done all the septic screen and meningitis panel, which was negative. So there was a strong suspicion of IEM. So then ABG was done, which showed respiratory and alkalosis, and the ammonia levels were more than 500. So the first diagnosis, which was in our mind, was urea cycle defect. TMS, GCMS immediately was sent. At that time, the baby was on feeds. And treatment for hyperammonemia was started by starting sodium benzoate, and peritoneal dialysis was done for continuously 7 days. The ammonia, they went down. Benzoate infusion, oral benzoate and arginine supplementation was done. Urine GCMS showed increased orotic acid, and TMS showed high glutamine levels and decreased level of citrulline, etc. So the diagnosis of ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency, which is a kind of urea cycle defect, is confirmed. And finally, the molecular genetic testing confirmed the diagnosis. Genetic counseling of the parents was done, prenatal testing clearly advice, and long-term therapy in form of low protein diet and nitrogen scavenger therapy if needed was explained to the parent. So this was again a case in which there was a 13-day female. She was full term, immediate cry on day 6, became lethargic, excessive sleepiness, decreased activity and hiccups. And the investigation, so it was basically a metabolic encephalopathy on day 6. And CSF examination was normal. So there was no sepsis, no meningitis. Lactate pyruvate ratio was normal. And CT brain was normal, CRP was positive. There was deep severe encephalopathy with low acidosis. TMS showed increased level of lactate and these metabolites. So finally, the diagnosis by GCMS was confirmed as maple syrup urine disease, and dietary restriction, especially the special formula, which do not have the branch chain amino acids, were imported. And avoid IV lipid and high concentration of glucose. Also, genetic counseling was given. Another, this was a 3-day-old baby. He cried immediately and became tachypneic after 48 hours. In ABG, had severe metabolic acidosis with a high anion gap, more than 16. Lactate was high, and CSF lactate pyruvate ratio was also high. So the first organic acidemia was the first possibility, and diagnosis was confirmed by GCMS. B12 and carnitine therapy was started along with the restriction of protein intake. So any child with unexplained neurological deterioration, unexplained metabolic acidosis, hypoglycemia, ketosis, hypotonia, please suspect IEM. And the key messages, it requires a high index of suspicion as they mostly present with non-specific symptoms. They're individually rare. However, totally they account for 20% of the diagnosis in extremely sick newborns in the NICUs. Newborn screening is very, very essential for the early intervention. And establishing a diagnosis is very important even before the neonatal, even after the neonatal death has occurred in the index case, so that to facilitate for the prenatal diagnosis. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shalini and Dr. Mandakini. So I would like to introduce our second speaker, Dr. Sunita Bijania. She's a senior consultant at the Institute of Medical and Genetic and Genomics at Sri Gangaram Hospital. And she's also a professor at GRIP Amar, SGRH in New Delhi. So Dr. Sunita also has area of special interest in inborn errors of metabolism, development, and fetal genetics. She has an experience in medical pediatric education. She graduated in 1992 from LHMC in New Delhi, and she did followed by that she did a post graduation from DCH from MAMC in New Delhi and DNB in pediatrics from Sri Gangaram Hospital in New Delhi. She has a fellowship in genetic and metabolic disorders from Sydney. She's currently working as a clinical and metabolic geneticist at Institute of Medical Genetic and Genomics, Sri Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. She has approximately 20 years of experience in genetic industry. Over 100 publications, in peer-reviewed journals, and 7 chapters in various books on IEMs. She's also the founding executive member at Indian Society for Inborn Errors of Metabolism, corresponding member for Indian and Council member of SSIEM, and executive member of Society of Fetal Medicine. She is on the editorial board. She's an editorial board member of Indian Pediatrics Journal of Fetal Medicine. And she has current research in genetic etiologies in childhood neurogenesis, LSD, genetically determined leukodystrophies and mitochondriopathies, and carrier screening for common AR disorders in healthy people. So over to Dr. Sunita Bijania for her talk.
Thank you very much, Geeta. And I really thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to be amongst you, August audience. I would like to start my presentation. I'll just start sharing. Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Dr. Shalini has done an excellent job, and she's really reduced my efforts in making you explain about all the inborn errors of metabolism. So just start with a little introduction. This is a very nice slide handed over to me by Dr. I.C. Verma, who's my mentor and guide. So a little girl was adopted from China about a century ago at the age of 3 months by an American mother. The little girl had unusual beauty. She had blue eyes, but then she later developed developmental delay. So no one could tell what was wrong. And she did have a musty odor in her urine as a child. So what she had was a metabolic condition called PKU, or phenylketonuria. So this was the mother. So she wrote in her book, The Child Who Never Grew. And this was penned down by What Has Been Need Not Forever Be So by Mr. Pearl Buck. So this actually is, triggered or started off the story of inborn errors of metabolism. Really, it was Sir Richard Garrett who had started, but then in terms of actively managing such children with metabolic conditions, this was the start. So we know that these IEMs are increasingly being identified, and even so in our own country, because we have so far, overcome the major hurdles of, managing the children with birth defects, with sepsis, not birth defect, but birth asphyxia, sepsis, etc. So we do have improved ICU care facilities. And then, of course, we have lots of births in our country, and we do have a lot of consanguinity in our country, not only in just the Muslim population, but also pockets where Hindu population is also having consanguinity. So overall rate of consanguinity in our country is about 10%. And as you can see, a little higher in the southern part of country, which could be as high as 30%. So all these factors do contribute to an increased recognition of these IEMs, which is really important. because not only are they common, of course, individually they may be rare, but as a group they are quite common. But they do also mimic some very common conditions, like Dr. Shalini has informed you already. So they do present with features of sepsis, intoxication, even vitamin deficiency, etc. The good part is that there is a treatment for many of these inborn errors of metabolism. So all we have to do now is to diagnose them early, so that therapy can be given to them timely and we can save their lives, and not just their lives, but also prevent disability. So hence, this is a very, very good ground to start newborn screening. Newborn screening is an excellent proposition for such inborn errors of metabolism, where the newborns are born healthy, but do go on to develop the disorder and hence go down the path of development and neurological disability and even early death. So all that can be prevented once we diagnose by newborn screening. Of course, genetic counseling is really, really important, because they are all genetically determined disorders and they are not just one in a family. There is a risk of recurrence. If there is one baby in the family that's born, that increases the risk to 25 to 50%. And of course, once we know what the disorder is, then one can go on to do something about it, which means that one can do a prenatal diagnosis in the subsequent pregnancy. Each subsequent pregnancy will have to be tested in order to detect the inborn error in the fetus. So let's start with a few steps. Dr. Shalini has already made my job easier. First and foremost is to think metabolic. It has to occur in our mind. We have to have a high index of suspicion. So it should come as soon as the other diagnosis come. Like if a baby who's sick in the nursery, you are thinking in terms of sepsis, why not think of IEM at the same go? Why should you put it in the last of the list? So it should not be a diagnosis of exclusion, because you waste time, basically, even though you think that it is rare. But if you are thinking about it, think then and there. So deterioration, the major points in children who present with IEMs are, of course, there are variable periods of normalcy that can last in the newborn period from hours to days to even weeks. Then once the symptoms occur, they are rapidly progressive. And about more than 70-80% of these babies present with encephalopathy, and you really don't know what's the origin. You don't come to know why the baby is going into encephalopathy. Then, of course, there are certain very common tests that we do, like metabolic acidosis and seizures. They present with hyperammonemia and hypoglycemia. Step two is go back into the background, ask the family about any particular history as such. So because most of these IEMs are recessive, which means that unless a baby receives both the faulty copy of the gene from each parent, the disorder does not come. But it's possible for siblings to inherit the same combination of defective alleles from both parents. And that's why consanguinity increases the risk. If there is a history of previous neonatal deaths or even fetal losses in siblings, one should alert you to thinking about these kind of genetic disorders, which are autosomal or X-linked recessive. So, of course, if there is a history where the parents say that only the male babies die, whereas the females are surviving and doing fine, it is a clue towards X-linked condition. And certain disorders are common in certain ethnic populations. So, for example, there is the disorder of MSUD is quite common in the Amish American community. So, like, we also have a few conditions which are common in our own community. So it's important to give a good physical exam of the baby. So, because, of course, they're usually normal, except for some non-specific findings like lethargy, coma, apnea, hyperapnea, seizures, hypotonia. But some clinical clues you can still get. For example, there could be cycling movements in the baby, which can alert you towards the diagnosis of MSUD. There could be an abnormal odor. There could be dysmorphism, as we see in peroxisomal disorder. There could be polydactyly, as we see in other conditions like SNO. So then a few other specific things that we can look in the baby is the abnormal odor. So there are certain characteristic odor that the baby gives and which can lead us to a diagnosis. For example, the urine is musty in odor in phenylketonuria, which is like mousy sort of thing. Then stale cabbage sort of odor in tyrosinemia, maple syrup or burnt sugar-like odor in MSUD, sweaty feet odor in isovaleric acidemia, cat urine odor in 3-MCC and other multiple carboxylase deficiencies. So there are certain clues that we get, but it's not very practical though. Then in step four, we go on to the laboratory tests. And of course, they are to be done in acutely ill children because that's the time when these abnormal metabolites are excreted in your blood and urine. So a good time to catch them. So routine investigations include urine reducing substances, which could be glucose, even non-glucose, then ketones, pH, and some certain very simple chemical tests can be done, such as the ferric chloride and the DNPH. We look at the blood gases, electrolytes, then anion gaps, liver function, like any other sick baby. All these tests are done in almost all the children, except we could add about the ammonia and the lactate in this diagnostic algorithm. So basically, we put them together in one set of tests, which is called basic metabolic tests, where one could come with an acronym of GLAC, which starts with G for glucose, E for electrolytes, L for lactate, A for ammonia and a blood gas, and K for ketones. Apart from the GLAC, there are other investigations that will be very helpful in a diagnosis. Now, do these abnormalities suggest an inborn metabolic disorder? Well, they could be yes or no. If they do not suggest, but still there is a good history, like there has been a recurrence and the clinical symptoms are very suggestive, like seizures or liver disease or cardiomyopathy, then one must continue our search for our inborn errors of metabolism. And of course, if the biochemical tests do give us a clue, so for example, there is high ammonia or there is an increased blood acidosis or there is hypoglycemia causing all the encephalopathy in the baby, then of course, these are good grounds to go ahead and continue our diagnostic algorithm. So as Dr. Shalini has already said, there are a lot of inborn errors of metabolism and one can categorize them into acute and chronic. And the toxic, the toxicity related or energy deficiency related. So there are very many ways of classifying. And a little clue is, of course, the timing in our lives. So whereas the timing can be different for any disorder, but typically when it comes to newborns, the urea cycle, majority of them present in the newborns, the severe ones. Those who do not present in the newborn are not that severe. So, but they can present later. Then NKH, organic acidemia, MSUDs, they're all quite frequently presenting in the newborn period, not so much as later. Then another group of disorders of inborn errors that can present is with seizures. But these seizures are really unexplained and intractable. They would not respond to your usual antiepileptics. So these are the disorders which are very many, but like typically it is the vitamin responsive disorders, the pyridoxine dependent disorder, where you have to actually give a therapeutic trial of pyridoxine / pyridoxine 5-phosphate in good high doses in order to achieve the therapeutic potential. Then urea cycle, organic acids, MSUD, NKH, fatty acids, they're all such disorders that can present with seizures and they can also go unexplained unless you go around doing all the metabolic tests to diagnose them. Sulfite oxidase, Dr. Shalini has already explained to you. Ammonia, I thought just it's worth a mention because not only is it really, really important to do it, but it is not really available in majority of our hospitals. So all of you doctors, I request you to go back and start this testing in your own hospital, or you have to identify a lab nearby who will test this. Because unless and until you do the ammonia test, you will never know whether that baby had hyperammonemia or not. It's not that difficult. It is an easy assay, but you do need to start it. So there are few sample requirements. It is a blood sample, but it should be free flowing. And that's why we say that at least in newborns, one could start with doing arterial sample. And of course, it has to reach the laboratory immediately, because with every minute of normal body temperature of blood, the ammonia would keep on rising. So unless it is sent to the lab immediately, which is like next door, one should transport this sample on ice. And again, not waste any more time. So your ammonia is elevated in lots many disorders, but very typically in urea cycle disorders and organic acidemia. This is a little baby who presented in the neonatal period with hyperammonemia and was diagnosed to have arginosuccinic aciduria. This was another boy who presented at 5 years of age with developmental delay and hypotonia, and who on MRI had few characteristic findings of maple syrup urine disease. His diagnosis was confirmed on urinary GCMS. So in acid-base studies, there is a 2-day-old baby who becomes tachypneic and goes off his feet. He subsequently becomes comatose and started seizure. So what could be the possibility? There could be n number of possibilities, because this is such a common presentation. Tachypnea, seizures, lethargy, and off the feeds. So basically, we need to focus on the common ones presenting in the age group, which are organic acidemias, renal cardiac disorders, mitochondrial, pyruvate dehydrogenase, pyruvate carboxylase deficiency, etc. If the baby has metabolic alkalosis instead of acidosis and is similarly sick, comatose, etc. with seizures, of course, the diagnosis would go into favor of urea cycle. So these are the few other organic acidemia. In children who present with hypoglycemia, of course, one could very easily exclude children who are small for dates, preterm, diabetic mothers, and perinatal asphyxia, then categorize them whether they have ketotic hypoglycemia or hypoketotic hyperglycemia, because there is a lot of difference between the two. Whereas ketotic might be normal, not so much in the newborn period, but it is the hypoketotic, the baby who is hypoglycemic yet not producing enough ketones, is the one which is either due to overutilization, whether it is due to hyperinsulinism in the body, or it could be due to fatty acid oxidation disorders. Then similarly, hepatic conditions can be divided into many other presentations. And we can diagnose such children, such as galactosemia, tyrosinemia, mitochondrial, peroxisomal, and a few storage disorders, or such as lysosomal storage disorder, based on their hepatic dysfunction. This is a little boy who presented about 20 years ago with this presentation of doll-like faces and progressive abdominal distension. His liver was quite huge, and he was diagnosed to have glycogen storage disorder. He's doing quite well now. Now, other conditions with liver disease are galactosemia, where you can diagnose by specific enzyme assays. So there are typically 3 enzymes. Now, there is another 4th one of the Liloyl pathway. But GALT, that is the transferase enzyme, is the most important and the most common. Then we can also have epimerase enzyme assay, as well as galactokinase enzyme assay. They're all available in our lab, as well as in other leading biochemical genetics laboratories. Galactose is a metabolite that can be tested, and based on its elevation, one can give a diagnosis. Other conditions causing liver disease are hereditary fructose intolerance or fructosemia, and this is a really important condition, which is tyrosinemia type 1. So here the children present with progressive liver failure with coagulopathy. And this is the pathognomonic metabolite that is present in the urine of this baby, which is called succinylacetone. So what happens is that in the pathway of breakdown of these amino acids, phenylalanine and tyrosine, there are a few steps. And then along the line, at the end of the 4th step, the one particular metabolite is then finally converted to fumaric acid and acetoacetic acid, both of which enter the Krebs pathway and give rise to energy. So this is an energy producing catabolic pathway of amino acids, phenylalanine and tyrosine. The tyrosinemia type 1 is due to the defect in the last, the ultimate step of catabolism, which leads to accumulation of this particular metabolite, the fumaryl acetoacetate, which then converts into succinyl acetone, which is a very toxic metabolite for the neurons as well as other organs. And that's how the symptomatology arises. Now, the treatment is very intriguing, and it came around by because of serendipity, is because there is the involvement of this, the enzyme, about three steps behind the final enzyme pathway, the step, and the drug called NTBC or nitisinone is able to inhibit this particular enzyme, catalyzing this step. Now, with this introduction of this drug, NTBC, one is able to stop the production of this toxic metabolite, succinyl acetone, and that's why all the symptoms can be abated because of this. And then one has to, of course, deal with the high tyrosine. So with the high tyrosine, this can be managed by diet. So there are, you can give protein-restricted diet and also give supplemented with a special formula, which are free of tyrosine and phenylalanine, so that they give all the other protein amino acids except this. So that's how these children do well. They continue to do well, most even up to 25 years of introduction of this drug. Cardiomyopathy has been taken up by madam. So once we are done with our routine basic metabolic testing, one can switch over or advance to more specific metabolic testing or advanced testing. TMS, of course, we still consider this as an advanced metabolic testing. However, in the world literature, this really is a basic metabolic test. This is a one test which can give you a diagnosis of many conditions. And of course, these are the major common genetic conditions, metabolic conditions that we have all talked about. So they are amino acids, they are fatty acids, and they are organic acids. Of course, there has to be a disadvantage. It does not pick up all the disorders like mitochondria or even many urea cycles are not picked up as such TMS condition. Now, GCMS or gas chromatography mass spectrometry is traditionally or conventionally performed in urine, although it can be performed in any body fluids. These are specialized metabolic testing. And of course, this is also a type of test which gives, which is the test for many conditions. And of course, organic acidemias are the most common and hence the mainstay of diagnosis of MMA, MSUD, etc. is by GCMS. So these, one can say that GCMS is a confirmatory test for MMA, PA, MSUD, which can be also screened from by TMS. So TMS is the screening test. GCMS is the confirmatory test for such conditions. But GCMS, the equipment can be applied to diagnose many other conditions such as peroxisomal via a test called very long chain fatty acid assay. Then one could also determine neurotransmitter disorders using this GCMS. And of course, other than genetics, it is also used very commonly in toxicology. Now, it's usually done along with TMS, as these two tests actually complement each other and they do pick up majority of the common IEMs. This is one example of a GCMS. Of course, Madam Dr. Shalini has already told you about this. So this is just to summarize the levels of testing. So biochemical testing for IEMs can be put at three levels. The first is the basic metabolic testing, as I told, like the GLAC algorithm, glucose, electrolytes, lactate, amino acid base, and ammonia, and ketones. Then level two is our advanced biochemical testing, which could be the TMS or MSMS, GCMS, or the UPLC or the amino acid assays that we can do. And sometimes we also do enzyme assays, such as the biotinidase, the galactokinase, the galactogalt enzyme assay, and also enzyme assays for the lysosomal storage disorders. Then going on to level three, which is really the genetic testing. So once we have diagnosed all these conditions using our advanced biochemical methods, and if we are able to come to one diagnosis, say for example, galactosemia, so we don't need the NGS or the next generation sequencing for that. One could easily go on to checking that one single gene by Sanger sex sequencing. However, if there is a condition such as MMA, which has more than one genes responsible for, or even MSUD, where there are multiple genes that are giving rise to the same condition, and it is next to impossible to diagnose them on a biochemical basis, then one needs the NGS, the next generation sequencing technology, to determine the genetic defect in these individuals. So the next generation sequencing is basically a sequencing technique. So these are all tools to sequence a particular gene. So sequencing of many genes together is what is done in the next generation sequencing. It can do sequencing of a few genes, like we can set up a panel of testing, say for MMA or for any other such condition, or you could do what is called a clinical exome sequencing, the CES, or even a whole exome sequencing, which includes all the known genes in our body. And one could even go on to the level of whole genome sequencing, which means sequencing of the DNA, even other than the gene, of the DNA, which is not even part of the gene. So, of course, there is no dearth of advancements in this particular field, but this is not the topic for today. So we'll stick to metabolic testing. A little bit about TMS or MSMS. Basically, it is a path-breaking technology. It has revolutionized at least the biochemical genetic testing. It came around in the early 90s. So basically, the idea is to determine the ions, the smaller molecules in our body or any body fluids, and detect them with as much accuracy as possible. So the sample that is inserted in the ionization chamber, which can be a blood spot, is then further entrusted upon into a mass analyzer. So this is the first mass spectrometer. And then what it does, it has a quadrupole, it has a magnetic field, it has got four of these poles. And based on the magnetic field, these are ionized into various different ions, which are quite specific. And then once the ions have been made, they go on to a collision chamber where they are dissociated. And then again put in the second mass analyzer, after which they are targeted on towards a detection plate. Now this detection plate is attached to a monitor or the computer, which takes in all the signals and converts them into peaks. So the software is analyzing all the ions that are detected with their reasonable abundance, so you can know how much that metabolite is, and also with accuracy, because two or three ions put together will form one molecule. So that's how there is a specific pattern of ionization for each molecule. So it's a very, very sensitive tool to detect a majority of these small molecule disorders. So like 30 disorders can be detected with use of this. And to make it even more sensitive, a liquid chromatography machine has also been added to the MSMS. So now it becomes LC-MS. So there are various applications for these LC-MSMS, and majority of them include all the amino acid disorders, organic acidemia, and fatty acid oxidation disorder. But we must also know what it does not screen for. It will not screen for mitochondriopathies, purines, pyrimidines, neurotransmitters, CDGs, even for very long chain fatty acid, they need a different application. OK, Okay. Well, it has now been started. One could use them for VLCFA. One could use the LCMS to do many more tests, such as biomarkers for lysosomal storage disorder, even for CDGs. But it cannot be the same application that puts you, gives you the answer for all these disorders. So what are the requirements for such a test? So the laboratory requires blood to be put on filter paper and dried. So it's a dried blood spot, and it's a random sample. The blood should drop freely onto the circle, and it should, the blood should be visible on both sides, and there should only be one drop dropped on that particular area, because if there are two drops, then it doubles the amount of blood in the same sample. So it cannot be quantified. And of course, it has to be air dried to avoid contamination. So once we are through with the diagnostic algorithm, one can also employ one more thing, which is the response to treatment. So basically, this is quite an olden technique, but it still holds true. So whether there is a brisk or a poor response to conventional or supportive treatment, hypoglycemic encephalopathy characteristically responds briskly to IV glucose. So, but if there are conditions where they are not responding even to IV glucose and you need higher, then they are conditioned mostly that of hyperinsulinism. Whereas fatty acid oxidation disorders will respond very quickly to IV glucose. Then for lactic acidosis, due to mitochondrial electron transport chain defects, they are typically resistant to supportive treatment. They will continue to deteriorate despite your treatment for acidosis. Then seizures associated with IEM are typically resistant to conventional anticonvulsant therapy. Like we said, say, Madam Dr. Shalini told you about MMA responding to vitamin B12. So there is a subgroup of MMA, which is called vitamin B12 responsive MMA. Not all MMA will respond, but those who do, they show a very drastic, very good response. Just a few slides to show that other than biochemical tests, one needs a few more algorithms to find the diagnosis. So, for example, in this child who has Minkey syndrome, it was the hair that was the diagnostic area, and this is microscopic examination of the hair, which shows the twisting. And in this particular boy who presented regression, it was the cherry red spot in the fundus that gave away the diagnosis of T-Sachs disease. So let's just recap. Basically, for diagnosis of inborn errors of metabolism in all age groups, especially babies, one should start thinking about metabolic condition. We must have a high index of suspicion in all the babies who are presenting with very common, repertoire of clinical conditions such as lethargy, seizures, refusal of feeds. Then one must go on to the background family history to get a suspicion. And then simple observations like urine odor can help, followed by basic metabolic testing and advanced metabolic testing. In the treatment, the treatment is improving day by day. The standard treatment for many conditions is dietary restriction and along with elimination of the substrate, and high dose of vitamins work well for certain conditions. Enzyme replacement therapy is available for few lysosomal storage disorders, not all conditions. Then enzyme inhibition, like I said, in the tyrosinemia type 1, one could do utilize that only if it is it proves to be right. Then sometimes organ transplantation is quite helpful. Say, for example, in children with tyrosinemia or with urea cycle disorders, one could employ liver transplantation as a good one-time treatment, because basic all these types of biochemical pathways are carried out mostly in the liver. And by transplanting with a normal liver, one could treat or cure the condition. Then similarly, bone marrow transplant, where you're actually supplying the stem cells as a replacement, which will then start to function and make the enzyme, which was deficient in the body, is utilized for many metabolic conditions, such as mucopolysaccharidosis type 1, etc. Then gene therapies, of course, we're all looking forward to gene therapy coming. And we have seen it coming to reality in conditions like spinal muscular atrophy. So why not in the IEMs? They are just around the corner. So these are some special dietary formulae that are employed for dietary management. Now, genetic counseling remains the center of all the genetic conditions. Whatever the condition, one has to inform the family about the genetic nature. All IEMs are hereditary. Families should be informed about the condition, about the prognosis of the patient, not only of the patient, but also for the risk factors in all other, like the siblings. There is a recurrence risk for the parents to have another baby with same problem. It could be a risk to a maternal aunt for an X-linked condition, such as like that. Possibility of prenatal diagnosis should be discussed. And of course, to work for the prenatal diagnosis, one has to do some further workup and get an accurate diagnosis in the affected child first. And of course, screening of other members, female carriers of X-linked disorders may be at risk for milder disease. So it's not as if the X-linked condition do not manifest in girls. They can, but maybe not that. So now coming to newborn screening. Basically, I want to tell all our esteemed obstetrics group in this webinar is that this is one thing that can be a strong point for you. You can actually lobby for it. So it has been one of the top 10 medical triumphs of the last century. And it started in the 1960s with the screening for PKU. Dr. Shalini told about Dr. Robert Guthrie. He's the father of newborn screening. And with the formulation of WHO screening guidelines they are all being followed now. And thus many more disorders are added. So with the start of newborn screening, there was a boost in the technology boost in newborn screening by MSMS technique, which made the screening for multiple disorders through one test possible. And of course, 2013 was the year when the next generation sequencing was started for newborn screening, although it is still very, very debatable. So newborn screening is an essential public health program that prevents catastrophic health consequences through early detection, diagnosis, and treatment. It is a complex system of testing, evaluation, and treatment that is dependent upon dedication of persons working within the system. And obstetricians are the integral part of it. A system that, when designed properly, reaches all newborns rapidly and effectively. So these are the Wilson and Younger criteria laid down by WHO in 1968. And newborn screening actually ticks all the 10 criteria. This is the situation of newborn screening in the world. While we see that more than 90% of the Western or developed world is covered with newborn screening, in our country, the screening is about less than 3%. It's really, really sad to see this. So what can we do? So I would suggest, while it is a subject taken up by state governments, so it is really the onus of the government to implement newborn screening program as a whole, because it is a program and it needs to touch every newborn baby. And that's why it should be a state-funded public health program. However, we can do our little bit as doctors or as parents. So we can start with the awareness for these metabolic disorders, who can then be screened in the newborn population. Each couple visiting the antenatal period should be informed about newborn screening. One can start with one disorder, like congenital hypothyroidism, which is not an inborn error of metabolism, but it is a very serious disorder causing mental retardation if not treated. And it is very common in our country. And it is the easiest to treat. It is just one tablet of thyroxine that we have to give every day. Then as we establish ourselves in this newborn screening with one disorder, one could keep adding more disorders, such as the congenital adrenal hyperplasia, G6PD, biotinidase, and then move on to MSMS, which can then pick up so many IEMs. So give a healthy start to life. Prevention is better than cure. Of course, not all IEMs have a good treatment. So that's why one should not forget the prenatal diagnosis, especially in our country, which is still developing. And therefore, we need to know about prenatal diagnosis. So the first and foremost prerequisite for a prenatal diagnosis is an accurate diagnosis. Now you see the picture of two boys who look quite similar. One could say that it's easy to diagnose. They both have mucopolysaccharidosis. They both have MPS, but there is a lot of difference between the two. While the first one was diagnosed to have MPS type 1, which is due to another genetic gene, the gene for MPS 1 is different. The second boy has MPS type 2, which is another disease, Hunter disease. The first hurler, second hunter. So the prenatal diagnosis will depend on the accuracy of your diagnosis. If one cannot go for prenatal diagnosis of all the MPS disorders, it will not be feasible. That's why one should know the exact diagnosis. That can come by enzyme assays in this particular case, or by genetic testing, which could be targeted Sanger sequencing, or by NGS. So basically, early referral to genetic center for a diagnosis, even before pregnancy, at the time when the couple have come to you or planning a pregnancy, or they have seen the child getting affected. So that's the time when they should need to go to a genetic center for a precise diagnosis, where they will be counseled about the next pregnancy. So that's how prenatal diagnosis becomes the most effective. Coming to my last slide, IEMs are not rare. Every practitioner has come across them. You may not have diagnosed them, but you must have suspected them at some time or the other. So many, majority of these IEMs are treatable. And therefore, there is the very strong point that you must diagnose them as early as possible. Early diagnosis, most beneficial. Hence, newborn screening. Then IEMs with increased severity or with no treatment at all, they still need to be diagnosed, especially for the family. Because if they were to go for a prenatal diagnosis, nothing will be enabled except an accurate diagnosis. So please suspect, refer, and follow up all your patients who have IEM, and of course, spread the word. Save samples of babies who are dying, because of course, one cannot save all the babies, and there are certain conditions which inevitably you will lose the babies. But what we have to do is, we have to save a little bit of sample so that the genetic testing can be carried out. Umbilical cord is a very good source, and a dried blood spot is a very simple, blood put on a filter paper and kept can stay for very long. Thank you very much. I'm ready for questions.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Sunita, for that nice talk. Very, very difficult subject. For us, at least, it is most difficult. And the most, this thing is that we get to see these couples attending after losing more than one babies.
Yes.
So your last slide with the information that if the baby is dying, keep at least 1 ml of blood, 2 ml blood on a EDTA sample, keep it in the fridge. This will not be destroyed. This can be kept for a long time for next generation sequencing. And second thing is, which earlier used to be very, very costly. Now the cost has decreased. Most of the tests are affordable. So we can go ahead and do the test, pinpoint them. So if there are any questions, we can take it up. Yeah. It's many people thanking both of you for informative talk. Good and explanation. The question, I don't see any question. Geeta, if there are any.
Yes, I'm also checking Dr. Mandakini. There are no questions as such. It's just compliments, excellent presentation. And everyone is thanking Dr. Vijani and Dr. Shalini, and you and Medjinum. So yeah, only the comments.
Yeah. So if there are no questions, and then thank you so much. From my side, which are the couples where we definitely go ahead and do a testing for the couple? Previous baby died or previous one child, two children died. Which symptoms will tell us that yes, must test with NGS? No previous testing were done, nothing was available. So now the couple has come to us with that history. So what will prompt us testing a couple for NGS?
Yes, sir. So this is a very common scenario. We do get many couples come to us after having lost at least one or two or three babies with similar problems. So the clues are that they have to be similar sort of problems, and they could be boy and girl, or they could be two boys affected and things like that. There could be consanguinity in the family. But more commonly, what we tend to find is that they are same caste marriages. So this border, the boundary of caste, also makes a little difference, because we think that it is the couple are sharing the same gene pool, and hence it is a little less, but it is akin to consanguinity. So basically, these are all features suggesting an autosomal or X-linked recessive condition, and thus these sort of conditions can be picked up in the couple via carrier screening. So next generation sequencing or NGS is able to pick up the carrier status in the couple if we were to do it. But the important thing is the laboratory should be given as much clinical data as possible. Because if you do not give the precise clinical information, the laboratory will not be able to pick up the condition. And that's why we go really into the depths of what really happened to those children, if there are any medical records. Because nowadays, the TMS, GCMS is quite easily available. So the majority of the doctors do go for such testing. So you will find a report or two in their pile of medical records about such conditions. We can also find out about neuroimaging if it has happened. Sometimes there are biopsies, like liver biopsy, things like that. So these are very important medical clues that we get from the medical records of the children. Sometimes we go back and ask the pediatrician, and they also give us very vital information. So all these can help in detecting the disorder via the parents by carrier testing. Of course, it is not foolproof. One can miss disorder, but then this sometimes it is helpful.
Yeah. So one is looking into drawing a proper pedigree that we discussed earlier in our earlier sections. Second is to look into the previous records. But then, Dr. Salini, can you add anything more?
For the babies, ma'am, basically, we have to ask parents, because parents usually can tell that the baby has convulsions. Jo previous baby tha, uske andar jo death hua hai, usme convulsions hai, ya uske andar usko har bachcho ko jo hai wo pilia ho jata hai. Kahi baar wo symptomatology bata dete hain, to unko detail mein baat agar hum kare, to they come out of it ki whether the baby died because of encephalopathy. And we have to come out, especially neonatologists and pediatricians, we have to really come out from sepsis and HIE.
I fully agree, Dr. Salini, that if anybody, any cause of death was HIE or sepsis, then we still think about it. Two babies, consecutive baby, two children will not die of sepsis.
Every baby dying of HIE.
Definitely.
Of sepsis, then, all the three babies. So that may not be possible. We should be alert enough. And in fact, for the next pregnancy, we have to admit that baby, even if asymptomatic, and do that gradual introduction of the formula and TMS and GCMS if they are affordable, and to tell them the need of all these. Otherwise, they will just disappear. After discharge, the baby may die because of, again, happening the same thing to him.
Yeah. So one is having a history of convulsions. It may be attributed to, say, meconium aspiration or anything. Then any time hepatosplenomegaly. And then next is hypoglycemia, documentation of hypoglycemia.
Yes.
Yeah, ambiguous genitalia.
Nowadays, the parents, they are really, they really know what's happening in the nurseries and they know about the hypoglycemia. These terms they know.
Yeah.
Hypoglycemia hua tha and microcephaly hui thi, carnicterus hua tha. So they know all these things. They are educated enough to know our.
So these are few clues towards this. It may not point towards exactly what is the diagnosis, but in our history, we must include this list so that we can look into it. Next is what I think is the newborn screening. Dr. Sunita, probably in India, many centers are advocating hypothyroid screening, cord blood screening. But not all for newborn screening. So the same this one is asking, Dr. Kamal Patil is asking, most of the time in an antenatal clinic, they come without diagnosis for the index case. Can you do any carrier screening in the couple?
Through the next generation sequencing. So one can also imagine that one can do enzyme assays, but let me tell you that they are not reliable. So only the next generation sequencing is able to pick up not all the cases, but it has to be backed up with a really good clinical data.
Yeah, so very true that yes, we forgot about recurrent high drops, non-immune high drops.
Yeah,
that is another recurrent cause of this thing in
Yes, ma'am.
If we find such history, then we can ask the couple to go ahead for next generation sequencing. But the lab will be better placed if we have the history suggestive and any clinical data that including MRI that can be, the findings can be informed to the lab. So they will be better placed. So somebody is Dr. Susila is asking, can I have link for the recorded webinars, please? Yes, Dr. Susila, you Geeta, can you?
I'll take that question up. So all the recordings are available on MedGenome YouTube channel. So you can go and view the recordings there.
Okay. So somebody is asking for that, Dr. Vidhu Dhawan, very very nicely listening. So she is asking for the 10 criteria slide. If you can share.
Yeah. Shall I share, share again?
Yeah, please. Please do that.
Okay.
Ma'am, since we have the audience of obstetric people, so I would like to request everyone to start at least cord blood TSH in all the babies who are delivered.
Great. All newborn, like all birth.
Yes.
In your center, please do cord blood TSH. Yes, we do it.
Geeta, can you unshare? Yeah, please. So if one goes on to the internet also, one will find the Wilson and Youngner criteria. So these criteria are for general screening. It is applied in for newborn screening, but they can be used for any screening program. So you could take a screenshot.
Most likely thanks you for sharing that.
Thank you, madam.
Now hope we have covered many of the things. Thank you, Dr. Salini and Dr. Sunita, for that being with obstetrician who are always troubles you. But we always need your help. Yeah, we always need your help. It's the team which my best sentence is two brains work better than single brain. So I always feel that being a team together and definitely can serve the human being more better than thinking alone. So absolutely, that way we have come across all the way from for all these webinars. And I thank MedGenome for coming with this idea, having supported Foxy to have these webinar series of webinar every Thursday 3 to 5. And today is the last webinar that we have covered up. And President Foxy, Dr. Santa Kumari ma'am, Vice President, all of them, Dr. specifically Dr. Fessy Lewis, who is in charge of Genetics and Fetal Medicine Committee, and our Secretary General, to support this cause and to support that Genetics and Fetal Medicine Committee to go ahead with a series of webinar. The attendance may be less, but I feel that whosoever attend are interested in doing it. And if they can educate another 10 people, then it will be great. So thank you everyone, and thank you MedGenome. Gita, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Mandakini. So yeah, as you mentioned, this is our seventh and last webinar of the Foxy series, and we will be back soon with more webinars. So on behalf of the MedGenome team, I would like to thank Dr. Sunita Bijania, Dr. Shalini Tripathi, Dr. Usha Sharma, and special thanks to Dr. Mandakini for being so proactive and supporting us at every stage. And also thanks to the Foxy office members for providing their guidance. So if anyone wants to review these videos, it's available on our YouTube channel. And you can also write to us for more information at our email ID, diagnostics@medgenome.com. So thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye.